Are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon and welcome to the secret webinar with Ken Blanchard and Mark Miller. We are so thrilled that you've decided to join us for some amazing learning today. As we get started, I want to draw your attention to a couple of things. One is our hashtag for today's event. We're using the hashtag Secret10. If you'd like to join us in live tweeting this webinar, we would love that, and you'll see that hashtag as well as both Ken and Mark's Twitter handles at the bottom of every single slide. The second thing I'd like to draw your attention to is the question panel. We are looking forward to later in this call having some amazing Q&A time with Ken and Mark. It is such an amazing privilege to have them with us, and we all want to learn as much as we can. So please include your questions in the question panel. And just to get started, if you'd like to, why don't you go ahead and tell us where you're calling in from today so that we can get a sense of today's audience. I already see that we have someone from Ottawa, Ontario. And I also already see that we have a question about a replay. We are recording this event, and we will share it later in some follow-up emails. Oh my goodness, you all are answering this question so fast and so furiously. We've got Oakland, California, Frisco, Texas, Newburgh, Oregon, Plano, Texas. I see a caller from Bulgaria, Kansas, Chicago, Seattle, Arizona, Illinois, New York, Texas, Arizona, Missouri, Washington. I would not be surprised if we had a caller from every single state, and there are lots of countries as well. Oh my goodness. So thanks to all of you. We have a person from Romania. I'm curious too. We also have a caller from Albania. I think that Ken, you're calling in today from California. Is that correct?
Yes, I am.
And Mark, are you in Atlanta today?
I am in Atlanta today.
Very cool. And I think I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Becky Robinson, and I'm calling in from Michigan today. So thanks again for joining us. I'm going to take a quick moment to introduce our guests, although I think they may not need an introduction. As you might know, Dr. Ken Blanchard and Mark Miller wrote together 10 years ago a book called The Secret, What Great Leaders Know and Do. And that book has now sold over 500,000 copies. And it's because of that book that we're all here today. And I want to introduce Dr. Ken Blanchard first. He's the co-founder and chief spiritual officer at the Ken Blanchard Companies, which is an international management training consulting firm that he and his wife began in 1979 in San Diego, California. Ken is one of the most influential leadership experts in the world, and he's well respected for his years of groundbreaking work in the fields of leadership and management. He's also just the most down-to-earth, kind man. I'm so thrilled to have met him, and I'm thrilled to be able to learn with him today. I also want to introduce Mark Miller. My team and I have been supporting Mark for nearly 2 years this month, and it's been such a pleasure to support Mark as he's grown his influence online. But Mark has another job. He sells chicken. He's been working at Chick-fil-A since 1977. And if you want to do the math quickly, I think that's, is that 35 years, Mark?
It's a long time.
It's a really long time. So Mark serves as the VP for Organizational Effectiveness at Chick-fil-A, and The Secret is one of five books, is that right, Mark? Four books that Mark has authored. It's four and one on the way, right?
That's correct.
Okay, super. So I'm going to turn it over to our experts now, and one of the questions that I'm really excited to learn from the two of you is how the two of you met and how this book, The Secret, came into being 10 years ago. And I think Ken is going to tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, Becky, I had a pleasure a number of years ago to speak to all the managers and folks, good folks at Chick-fil-A, and later on wrote a book with Truett Cathy, the wonderful founder of Chick-fil-A, who passed away recently, called The Generosity Factor. And that process, I got to meet Mark, who's been with them, as you say, for so many years, and really heading up their organizational effectiveness and their training. And I tell you, it's no accident why Chick-fil-A outperforms all the quick service restaurants on there, because they really take care of their people, they train them and all. And Mark was sharing with me, you know, the basics of their training for all of their people. And it's the serve model that we'll be talking about today. And so we decided, gee, we ought to share that more widely. And so it's been a joy to work with Mark. We also followed our book up with a book called Great Leaders Grow. He's one of my very favorite people. Everybody in my office said, if all your co-authors were like Mark Miller, life would be easy.
Thanks, Ken. It's very kind. Very kind. Well, my version of that story is very similar, but there's a little difference. Is we had begun doing some work almost 15 years ago trying to figure out how we might accelerate leadership development here at Chick-fil-A. And when we did our initial work, we had what I described as a crisis of competence. We'd done this work, but we were painfully aware of the fact that we were out of our league. We sell chicken for a living, and we wanted to be sure that we got this right. And so we decided that we would approach experts in the field to get their perspective. And I actually was going to be with Ken the very next day because, as he mentioned, we had done some work together, not only on Truett's book, but some previous work with Chick-fil-A. And I shared with him the content that we're going to share with you today, but it was a single page with five bullet points on it. And I asked Ken, I said, Ken, we've been working on how to accelerate leadership development, and I want you to take a look at this and tell me if you think it's true and if it's valid and if you think it'll stand the test of time, and did we miss anything? And his response when he looked at that page was, this has got to be a book. And I dismissed it. I told Ken everything looked like a book to him, which is why he sold about 50 million books. But he persisted and said, you guys were trying to figure out what great leaders do at Chick-fil-A. He said, what you've done is you've articulated what great leaders have done throughout history. And so that actually began the journey that would become The Secret. And I'm so thankful for that encouragement and insight on Ken's part, because it's served our organization well. And as you said, we're very thankful that it has served leaders around the world over the last decade. So with that said, let me tell you how we began the process of actually trying to inculcate that here within our organization. Ken has challenged organizations for years with the question, what's your leadership point of view? And the truth is, we really didn't have one. Well, what might be a better way to describe it is we had scores or hundreds of different points of view on leadership. And so we began looking for a metaphor, and we actually discovered the iceberg. And many of you will remember back to fifth grade, about 10% of the iceberg is above the waterline and about 90% is below, and we think that represents leadership very, very well. The 10% above the waterline represent our skills, and the 90% below represents leadership character. Well, the book, The Secret, is about that 10% above the waterline. Ken, I don't know if you remember, but in the early drafts, we didn't even have this in the book because the book is about the 10% above the waterline, and we got some feedback on those early manuscripts that we had missed the most important part of leadership. And when we probed, we learned that people were talking about the issue of character. We said, oh, no, we understand how important that is, but that's a given. And they said, well, that's not a given in most organizations. And we said, well, we've made the fundamental decision that we're going to select for character and train for skills. And so when Ken and I added that at the beginning of the book, it was really an acknowledgement to the importance of character, but the book, The Secret, is about the 10% above the waterline.
Yeah, and I think, Mark, the key around character when you get to the acronym and great leaders serve is that's a hard issue, you know. You got to look inside, and that's a character issue. Are you here to serve or be served? And the leaders that are great are the ones that think that leadership is all about the people they're serving, not about themselves. And I think that's what's really important. And so at Chick-fil-A and companies like Southwest Airlines and Synovus and great companies, they all hire, as Mark said, for character. They try to find out what kind of people these are, and then we can always train for skills. You know, like Southwest said, we're not going to put a pilot up in the air who can't fly, but we're not going to put a pilot in the air who thinks they're a big deal. So character is really key, and then you teach them the skills.
Sure. And I will mention that I had the privilege to do a follow-up book. Ken was unable to do it with me, but it's called The Heart of Leadership, and it's actually about the character of a leader. We'll not go there today, but there is a resource that some of you might find helpful. So let's turn our attention to the skills. One of the things that we began to wrestle with early on is, what are the skills or practices of great leaders? And our initial research revealed hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of things that leaders do. I tell people it's somewhat validating that leadership is, in fact, real work, if there was ever any question. But we said it was not helpful to share with people hundreds of things that leaders do, but could we reduce it down to the critical few? And those are the five practices that Ken and I outline in The Secret. The first is that great leaders see the future. Ken, I like to tell people that leadership always begins with a picture of a preferred future.
Yes, Mark, because leadership is about going somewheres. And if you don't know where you're going, there's very little chance that people will get there. And if people don't have a preferred future or a vision about where they want to go, then the only thing to serve is themselves. And that often happens in organizations where they don't have a clear sense of the future and what their, you know, what business they're in, what their picture of the future is, and what their values are. And as a result, everybody is out serving themselves. So this is a really key element, and it's I think it's powerful, Mark, that it's first.
Yes, and I tell people, if you read much about leadership, there's a single word that encapsulates this idea, and it's vision. And you just gave us some great attributes of a fully orbed vision. Another way that I talk about it is I tell people it helps you answer questions such as, what are you trying to accomplish? What are you trying to become? What are you trying to achieve? And why does it matter? It's been a revelation for some leaders to realize that if it's not clear in their head and their heart, there's no chance that it can be clear throughout their organization.
And Mark, this is, to me, is the leadership part of servant leadership, because you need to have something that people are working towards and trying to become.
Yes, and I tell you this, just a cautionary note, because like you, Ken, I've had the privilege to teach this content now for more than a decade around the world. I find a lot of leaders who assume this is someone else's job. They assume it's their supervisor or their boss's boss or the president of the company or president of the nation, a global geopolitical leader. And I would say yes, 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 and yes. It's every leader's job to articulate a preferred picture of the future. And I have encountered some leaders that say, well, I don't lead people. And I said, well, you can start with trying to articulate the preferred future for yourself. Don't assume that this is someone else's job, because when we do that, we actually are forfeiting the opportunity for leadership.
Well, I definitely agree with that. And you know, kids look to their parents for vision and a picture of the future, you know, and people look to their manager, they look to the president. And all that unfortunately, you can't delegate that as a leader. It doesn't mean you don't involve people in the development of your preferred future, but it's your responsibility that it be clear.
Yes, and I will say, I believe the biggest challenge is actually not finding the vision. It's helping others catch it and keep it top of mind. Our slide here says, like water in a bucket, vision evaporates and must constantly be replenished. Yeah. I find
Mark, you get a kick out of it. I had lunch one time with Max Dupree, the legendary chairman of Herman Miller. And I said, what's your job as the great chairman of this great company? He said, Ken, I have to be like a third grade teacher. I have to say our vision and our values over and over and over again, so people get it right. And so you keep on communicating it, but you also keep on revisiting it to make sure that it's still relevant.
Yes, and as we coach our leaders, we challenge them, don't fall in the trap of communicating only in a style and a format that resonates with you. You've already got the vision. You've got to communicate it in many, many different ways. And I think you've got to do it the rest of your leadership life, because it's going to continue to evaporate. So that's the first practice. We believe that great leaders see the future. Next, they engage and develop others. As people's engagement level rises, so does the probability of success. Ken, my experience is of the five practices we're going to discuss today, many leaders will tell you that they spend more time here than in any of the other practices. Even though they're all ongoing, this one requires our full focus and attention as a leader.
Yes, and I think it's all important, because to me this is the servant part of servant leadership. And as I said, the vision, the preferred picture of the future and all is the responsibility of the hierarchy, even though you do involve people. But now when it gets to how you're going to accomplish and live according to the vision and accomplish your preferred picture of the future, now it's through your people. And philosophically, you have to turn the pyramid upside down. So now you're working for them. To engage and develop your people is, once you've hired them, you work for them. Your job is to help them get an A, help them become winners.
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned after you've hired them, because when we teach this to our leaders, we talk about engagement really having two fundamental components. The first is selection. Who do you engage? Who do you recruit? And who do you select? And then the second part is creating the context or the environment for success. We take selection very, very seriously around here. In fact, I tell folks we're over the top. I don't even suggest that anyone emulate us, but it's worked pretty well for us. We have about a 96% retention, both our corporate staff and our restaurant operators, year over year for several decades. And I think much of that can be attributed to the fact that we are very, very careful in the selection process.
Your turnover is pretty low compared to the industry, too, in terms of your hourly frontline employees, too, isn't it, Mark?
Yes, it is. Based on the data we've got, it probably runs about half the industry average, although we would love to push that down as low as we can and still maintain our youth-oriented workforce. We've got about 70% of our workers are under the age of 21, and we actually like that. We like the energy and vitality they bring to the business. You just got to understand that, by definition, that will inject a little bit more turnover. Ken, as it comes to creating the context or environment for success, I quote you often on this. Use the term in Sit Lead 2 about the enthusiastic beginner. Well, my question is, how enthusiastic are they 6 months later and 6 years later? And that has everything to do with the context in the environment that we create as leaders.
That's for sure. And, you know, this next slide, you'll see engagement, one size doesn't fit all, is that the key thing in training managers is to make sure they understand that they need to use different strokes for different folks. And find out who they are and what their needs are and how you can bring out the best in them.
Yes. Here's a question that I like to give our leaders. I encourage them to think of a time when they were fully engaged. And maybe it was at home, maybe it was at school, maybe it was on a team or in a club, may have been in this current job or in a previous role, but when were you all in? And then the question I ask is, what contributed to your level of engagement? And they come up with things such as, I was in the right job, or my opinion mattered, or I had appropriate coaching and feedback. I knew the score, implying that they were actually keeping score. I was bought into the vision and the mission. There are a lot of things that leaders control to directly affect the engagement of our folks. And so that's the second practice of great leaders. They spend a lot of time, energy, and effort engaging and developing others.
And just a comment here, Mark, you know, there's three parts of managing people's performance. Performance planning, where you set goals and objectives and make standards really clear. Then there's day-to-day coaching, when you work with them to accomplish their goals. Then there's performance evaluation, where you look at their performance over time. Unfortunately, most organizations spend the most time in evaluation, filling out forms and everything. And I'm amazed at the number of organizations that aren't clear up front about the preferred picture of the future and goals and all that kind of thing. And then the least of these things there they spend time is day-to-day coaching. And yet that's really where the development takes place. And once goals are clear, now it's your job to turn that pyramid upside down and do everything you can to help people win. So if they win, you win, and the organization wins.
Yeah, your insights on that have been very helpful for me over the years. Anytime I hear somebody talking about their performance management system doesn't win, I go to those three attributes. And as you've said, often they don't have all three of those elements. And in that case, performance management will fall short. So thanks for reminding us all about that. So the third practice of great leaders is they reinvent continuously. Ken, I always tell people, unfortunately, this sounds like a buzzword from the 80s, but it does a really nice job of capturing the essence of what we're trying to say here, and that is that progress is impossible without change. And I think leaders understand this at an intuitive level. It's often something that non-leaders struggle with, but I tell folks it's really a good litmus test. If a person doesn't like change, it doesn't mean they're a bad person, but it means you probably shouldn't put them in charge of anything.
Yes, and I think it's so important, Mark, when you realize this, that constantly people have to be looking at how do they grow and develop. I mean, that's why you and I did that follow-up book, Great Leaders Grow, you know, because if you're not growing and learning and changing, you might as well lie down and let them throw the dirt on you, you know, because you're on your way out. And as you've said many times, Mark, if you're not growing and learning, I mean, that's like oxygen to a DC sea diver. And change, to me, is synonymous with learning and growing.
Absolutely. Ken, we give our leaders three hooks to help them think about this, because this is actually a big idea. And we talk about self, which you just referenced. How are you reinventing yourself? Systems and structure. Let me say just a word about each of those. Again, you mentioned self. One of my most remarkable moments over the last decade was an afternoon that I got to spend with John Wooden at his home in California a couple of years before he passed away. He told me the story about every year in the off season he would take some facet of the game and study it the entire off season. And I said, exactly what did that look like? And he began to use rebounding as an illustration. Not only did he watch videotapes, he interviewed players, he interviewed coaches, he read all the books on rebounding. It was just fascinating to me that he said he had to keep learning and growing himself, or he couldn't help his team learn and grow and develop. I just thought that was a wonderful example of someone who was very accomplished, very successful, who said, I've got to keep reinventing myself.
Yeah, it's interesting. I interviewed John when he was 95 in a program, and one of my favorite questions to ask people, particularly older people, are the best years ahead of you or behind you? You know, and a lot of times people say, oh, how can I say best, you know, this and all. And I said, John, the best years ahead of you or behind you? He had this great grin. He said, Ken, I am so excited about the future. He said, the past is the past. I'm excited what I might learn. Plus, I'm going to get to be with Becky again.
Sure. Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
So that second arena is systems. And here's the way, for those out there on Twitter, this may be something for you. Hope is not a strategy. And we challenge our leaders, if you want better performance, if you want faster drive-through times, if you want more sales, if you want better profitability, if you want better retention, what are you willing to change to get a different and better outcome. Hope is a wonderful thing, but it's not a strategy for improvement. And we really have been hammering that with our leaders now for almost a decade. Third and finally is this idea of structure. I don't know that I was surprised, actually. Let me just say it like that. As I've traveled the world teaching this content, this is the one that is the stumbling block for most leaders. And I don't know if they just feel out of control. The truth is, most of us don't control structure unless you're the CEO or a division president or something of that nature. But I tell leaders, don't let yourself off the hook. If the structure is a problem, it's something that we have to try and influence. I see a lot of leaders that become a prisoner of the structure, and they say, well, that's just the way we're organized. And I say, no, we as leaders have to be architects of the future, and if the structure's not right, it will impede our growth and our progress.
Mark, I always love Peter Drucker said, nothing good happens by accident. You have to put some structure around it, you know. And so, for example, if you want to have a great relationship with your people and you want them to win and accomplish their goals, we'll put some structure around it, you know. And, you know, we recommend one-on-one meetings that you spend at least 15 to 30 minutes once every 2 weeks with each of your direct reports. You schedule a meeting, but let them set the agenda, and they can talk about anything, something personal. If they have a sick kid or something, you might have to work at home. They can talk about some goal. And if you met with your people 26 times a year for 15 to 30 minutes, no longer than 30 minutes, boy, you'd really be on top of things.
Absolutely. That's a powerful, powerful practice. The only other thing I guess we'll say about reinventing continuously is that if we don't do it, our business, our organization, and our people will become stagnant. We're aware of this with the retention rate that I referenced earlier. We just believe that we have got to be predatory regarding learning and new ideas, or it won't be good. The fourth practice of great leaders is they value results and relationships. Ken, I like the way you say this, that ultimate success always includes both people and performance.
It's not an either-or thing. A lot of times people, managers and leaders are nice to people as long as performance is going well. If performance is going down, boom, forget people. Let's downsize them, get rid of them. No, it's both and. In fact, I've found, Mark, the great thing about companies like Chick-fil-A and Southwest and Nordstrom's and, you know, Wegmans and all that is that they think their number one customer is their people. And if they take care of their people and empower them and train them and all, they'll go out of their way to take care of their customers. I mean, the second most important customers, people use their products and services. And they'll become raving fans and want to come back. And that takes care of the results. And so it's both people, both internal and external, and results.
Yes, and the power is actually found in the tension. And this may be difficult for a lot of the folks listening to this. In my experience, this is really hard for about 95% of the leaders in the world. And I tell folks, for the 5% that this is not hard, I don't even like you, because it shouldn't be that easy. For most of us, we have a natural bias that we're either more results-oriented or more relationship-oriented. And our challenge to our leaders is to own your bias, just accept the way you are, and then to compensate and find ways to do what you don't do naturally well better. I often like it to a leader who wears glasses. You wouldn't assume he or she was a lesser leader. You might say they're pretty smart, because they found something they didn't do well and they've compensated. So I encourage leaders to figure out what the prescription you need so that you can value both.
One of our favorite sayings, Mark, is none of us is as smart as all of us, you know, and you need to gather people around you that you know, store you up, fix you up, and you take care of them too, because together you're going to be something.
Yeah, and here's my final thought on this. If you want to maximize long-term results, we believe that it requires a focus on both. If you're a leader that says, I'm just going to focus on performance, you will be outpaced by the leader who says, I'm going to focus on both. And so that's what we're encouraging our leaders to do. The fifth and final practice of great leaders is they embody the values. This is because people always watch the leader. This is about building trust. This is about building confidence. This is about building fellowship. People always watch the leader, and they're looking for, I believe they're looking for clues regarding what's important, and they're also looking to see if you and I are trustworthy. Do we walk the talk?
Yeah, I always love St. Francis of Assisi said years ago, you know, by all means share the gospel, but only use words when necessary, you know, and so the way you really teach values is to behave them. And all, not talk about them.
Yeah, I wrote a post, Ken, just actually coincidentally, I wrote a post today on greatleaderserve.com entitled, I Follow What I See, Not What I Hear.
Yeah.
And it talks about the importance of establishing and living our values. Because the truth is, if we don't embody the values, we will forfeit the opportunity to do all the other things we've talked about. Because people really don't follow leaders that we don't trust. And if people say one thing and do another, that trust erodes very, very quickly.
And that really gets down. My dad, who was retired as an admiral, always said, Ken, the only thing you have in life is your integrity, which is do you walk your talk? Do you really practice your values?
Yep, that's really what it means to embody the values. Are your actions in alignment with your words? And I think you and I both agree that that's critical. That's critical if we want to be effective leaders. So the summary from all this, you guys are 10 steps ahead of us. Great leaders see the future, engage and develop others, reinvent continuously, value results in relationships, and embody the values. This was the single page that I gave Ken 12, 13, 14 years ago and said, is it true? Is it valid? Will it stand the test of time? And have we missed anything? And again, thanks for your encouragement, Ken, because great leaders have always been willing to serve.
Yes, and if you don't serve your people and your organization, you're serving yourself. And so that's why these are all important, starting with having a clear sense of the future and where you're headed and what you want to accomplish so people have something to serve, and then turning that pyramid upside down and serving the people and developing them, and in the process, you know, reinventing yourself continuously and your policies and your structure and all, also making sure everybody understands that you value both, you know, them as people as well as results. You're not running a country club, and in the long run, it all winds down with, are you walking the talk, are you embodying the values?
And, Ken, I will say this, I've had some fascinating conversations over the years, and I know you have as well, with leaders about this this idea. And some leaders say, so if I'm serving, am I leading? And I say, well, be careful there, because if I wash your car and walk your dog, that makes me a nice person to have around. It doesn't make me a leader. We believe these are five strategic ways that leaders serve. And so those other ways of service, I think, still add value. I think they actually soften our heart and prepare us for these more strategic ways. But these are the functions and roles that leaders must fulfill in order to lead well.
And I think that the fact that all of your owners and your, you know, folks that run your restaurants and your managers and all understand these is one of the reasons why you have such high retention, because the managers are effective using these, and their people want to work for them because they can see those in action.
Great. Well, let's do this. Let's flip it over and see what questions you may have, ladies and gentlemen.
Absolutely. So, Mark, lots of questions, and Ken, have been coming in while you've been speaking, and I'm going to share those with you. The first one is a question about reluctance from a person who isn't sure they want to lead. So how can someone who's reluctant to lead obtain the desire and drive to be a leader? And that's coming in from Virginia.
Well, the reality, Virginia, is you are a leader. You know, it's really interesting. I always like to ask people in my sessions, think of a person who impacted your life the most, you know, one or two people, and people do that. And then I said, how many of you mentioned the manager? And hardly ever they do, but they mention parents and their friends and relatives and, you know, all this kind of thing. And so leadership is an influence process. Anytime you're attempting to influence the thinking, beliefs, or development of somebody else, you're engaging in leadership. So you have no choice. You are a leader. The question is, do you want to be an effective leader or not? And if you do, then you will serve.
Thanks, Ken. Here's a question more about the writing process that the two of you have had together. In addition to writing The Secret together, the two of you also wrote a book called Great Leaders Grow. And Nathan is wondering how you collaborate on these projects.
Well, and Ken, you jump in here. On this particular project, we had an outline as represented by that single page. We had worked for a couple of years trying to figure out what we believed and what our point of view regarding leadership would be. And Ken was the one that challenged us that we had to do a book. And so the whole idea of a book was Ken's. I worked on the first draft. Ken helped me create the second draft. I worked on the third draft. Ken helped me create the fourth draft. We went back and forth. Ken, I don't know if you remember how many drafts we had on this book. I think it was 17. People ask me why. I said, because I sell chicken for a living. And so it was a fun and elaborate process. I also remember that we had five editors, which I never recommend to any author that they have five editors. So that kind of compounded the situation. But
I think the key thing in terms of the writing I'd like to do, Mark and I, is we've first decided what the content would be, which was the CERT model, and then how could we create a story that told that, because I am just convinced that people love to learn through stories, and Mark is a great storyteller, I'm a storyteller, and all, and then we had to try to take that storytelling and put it into actually a story that this whole concept of serving and being in the serve model came out of. And that's what took a lot of time too, is to get the right story so people would go, whoa, this is something I'd like to share with everybody. Because when you talk about selling 500,000 books, that's not done by advertising and all those kind of things. It's word of mouth and pass along.
Absolutely. Well, thanks for that, Ken. I have a comment I want to share, and I'm hoping that the two of you can just talk about this again. Andrea was impressed by the comment, once you hire them, you work for them. And that has not necessarily been something she's seen in the workplace. And I'm wondering if you can say a little bit more about what that looks like.
Well, when you talk about working for somebody, you say it's for what? For accomplishing the goals and all. That's why you need the two parts of servant leadership, the leadership part, which is the vision and direction and goals and those kinds of things. And it's a responsibility of the hierarchy. And then once that's done, you need to turn the pyramid upside down and you work for them. I wrote a book with Gary Ridge, the president of WD-40, because he got excited. When I was a college professor, the first day of class, I used to give everybody the final exam out, you know, which to me is the whole performance planning. That's the, here's the vision, here's the direction. And faculty would say, what are you doing? I'd say, I'm confused. They'd say, I acted. You know, I thought we were supposed to teach these kids. You are, but don't give them the questions in the final. And I'd say, not only am I giving the questions in the final, what do you think I'm going to do all semester? I'm going to teach them the answers. So when they get to the final exam, they get A. Life's about getting A's, not some stupid normal distribution curve. And so Gary really said, well, why don't we implement that in organizations? And so we wrote a book called Help People Win at Work, a business philosophy called Don't Mark My Paper, Help Me Get an A. And so the whole serve model and what they do at Chick-fil-A is to help people get an A. Why do you think they have such great retention rate on their restaurant managers and all that? Because they're successful. And people like to, people who produce good results feel good about themselves. What do you think about that, Mark?
I agree completely. Yeah. I think there's a fundamental question that every leader has to wrestle with is, why am I leading? And I love the way Ken said it. We're trying to help other people win, and we're working for them. We're trying to set them up for success. And if you haven't considered it before, it'll change everything about the way you lead.
That is incredibly inspiring. So this next question comes in from Corey, and he's directing it to Mark, although I'm sure Ken could speak to it as well. He's wondering if you can describe in further detail the systematic approach to coaching in the growing and developing others' priority. What does that look like?
Well, here, let me give you a short answer, and I love Q&A, but my hesitation is always some questions like this one. They're big questions, so I don't want to trivialize it with a simple answer. But we ask people to consider, what is the role that you're in? What are your responsibilities? What is it you're paid to do? And we ask them to work that out with their supervisor. There needs to be some agreement as to what is your role. And we like to represent that in 4 to 6 key facets of your job. And then we start by trying to close any critical gaps. If there's something that is part of your role that you are not able to do successfully, we channel development there first. And I would even say exclusively. If you've got a critical gap, we've got to help you close it. And then once that gap is closed, or if there's no gap, we like to challenge people to leverage their strengths. Are there areas within your current role where you are really strong? Because we learned from Marcus Buckingham and the work that he and the Gallup organization did that people are going to learn faster, contribute more, and have higher levels of satisfaction when they play to their strengths. And so clarify the role, attack the gaps, and then leverage strengths. That's a quick 50,000-foot flyby as to how we approach performance planning, as Ken would call it.
Well, and how do you help people win, which is part of the question, is you observe their performance and praise progress, second secret of the one-minute manager, one-minute praising. If they're off base, you don't beat them up. You just redirect them and say, gee, let's get back to what we said we were trying to accomplish and make sure you're clear on that. So you're constantly observing and giving feedback and really being a partner. Not sitting around judging, you're there to cheerlead and coach and support and redirect.
All of that is really helpful. Thanks. I have a comment here from Mark who says that data shows that companies with a culture of servant leadership outperform others in the market. And he's wondering what, in your opinion, is the top reason that more leaders are not able to step into servant leadership and lead a culture of servant leadership?
Well, Mark, what do you think? I think it's the human ego.
I think ego is part of it. I think fear is part of it. I think the absence of role models. I mean, most leaders have not grown up in this mindset, and they've not been mentored. They've not been coached. It was countercultural 2,000 years ago when Jesus introduced the idea that those that want to be the greatest leaders must be willing to become servants. It was countercultural then. It's countercultural today. So I think there are any number of reasons, but ego may be chief among them.
Yes, and you make comment about role models. I was fortunate. My dad retired as an admiral in the Navy, and I'll never forget I won the president of the 7th grade in junior high, and I came home and I was pumped up, and I told my dad, and he said, congratulations, Ken. But now that you're president, don't ever use your position. Great leaders are great because people respect and trust them, not because they have power. And this was the beginning of him modeling leadership for me. And Mark, you were certainly given a great model in Truett Cathy of a servant leader in all of your years when you began at Chick-fil-A, because Truett was one of the great servant leaders I've ever seen.
Yes, absolutely. There's no question. But I can imagine there are probably a lot of people listening to this session who unfortunately have never worked for a servant leader. And it's hard to, I think for some people, it's hard to move in a new direction when you don't have the confidence of having seen someone else do it successfully.
That's for sure.
Well, you know, that brings up another question that had come in. Rob is asking, when you reference embody the values, if you could share some examples of what that looks like or what that means, or perhaps even someone who you've seen embodying the values. Perhaps you can speak to that next.
Well, I will say this, because I often get the question, which values are you talking about? And I say it doesn't matter, which actually freaks out some people. They go, what do you mean it doesn't matter? I said, no, because in this context, we're talking about leaders who walk the talk. So it's what the leader says is important. He or she lives like it's important. So in our context, if one of our restaurant operators talks about the importance of the customer, then he or she has to live like customers are important. I often share the story of the restaurant operator who said cleanliness is important. Well, if he or she doesn't pick up trash in the parking lot or pick up trash in the dining room, their team sees that. Remember, people always watch the leader, and they go, huh, he or she says that's important, but they don't live like it's important, so I wonder what else they're lying to me about. And again, you're moving down a slippery slope at that point.
So yeah, and I'll give you a little example. In our company, our number one value is ethical, doing the right thing, and number two value is relationships, developing a mutual trust and respect with our people, our customers, our suppliers, and the third value is success, running a profitable, well-run organization. In 2009, the economy went into the toilet, and we realized in February we're going to probably be 20 to 25% down on our financial sales projections and all for the year. And a lot of companies, with top managers, would go behind closed doors and say, okay, you know, who are we going to get rid of, you know, because that's where most of our costs are with our people. And we went right to our values, and we use a kind of an ethics check, you know, which is, you know, okay, is it, you know, with the ethics check, is it the right thing to do? You know, is it, you know, will it make sense and all that? And we said, you know, it's not the right thing to do is put a whole bunch of people out in the streets in a tough time like this and all. So we don't want to do that, and that doesn't consistent with our values around people and all that kind of thing. And so what we did is we're having our 30th anniversary at the Hotel Dell, and we, Coronado, a great hotel, we took the first day of a two-day supposedly party in celebration, brought outsiders in and divided our 300-plus people into small groups and said, why don't you come up with ways to cut costs and ways to increase revenue, because we meet once a quarter and we share with everybody the balance sheet and tell them what's happening, because they're very interested because of gain sharing and other things that we do. So we made them very much involved in the whole process. At the end of the year, we were down 20% of our projections, but we didn't let any people go. We didn't make a big profit, but we also didn't lose money because we pulled together with their suggestions. So that really went a long ways for people to say, gee, these values are not just on the wall. They practice these.
Thanks so much for that. So I have a question that came in on Twitter, and I just want to mention that we have tons of questions coming in on GoToWebinar. I know already that we won't get to them all, but I will be sharing these with Mark and Ken, and hopefully they'll use these later for blog post inspiration or be able to answer some of these after the call.
Hey, Becky, before
yes,
you
sir?
Read that last question, let me comment to that point.
Sure.
Every Friday, I do a post entitled Today's Challenge, and in that post, I respond to a question from a leader somewhere in the world. So I'll use these as input for that, but I mention it specifically because people may have questions a week from now or a month from now or 6 months from now. They'll send them to me via email. I every week I try to respond to a question from a leader. So maybe we can keep the conversation alive.
Absolutely. And I think that we have time for more than one. I just know that we're not going to get to all of them.
Sure.
So this next one says, as a student, what foundation for leadership should I make priority now before I step out into the real world? And just for a second, Nathan, you're already in the real world, but I'm sure he means, you know, the business world or whatever's next for him, and would love to hear your input on that one.
Ian, you want to take a shot at that?
Give me that again. He said, what should he do first?
Sure. What should he make a priority now as he's a student?
Well, I think the priority should always, every day, see if you can learn something new. I think reading, listening to videos, audios, going to seminars, constantly looking for opportunities to grow and develop, because becoming a leader is a lifetime journey. You know, I'm 75 now, and I'm still learning every day new kinds of things and new ahas. But I learn those from listening and reading and studying and all that kind of thing.
Becky, my answer was going to be exactly the same. Commit to lifelong learning, because he's a student now, but if he ever thinks he shouldn't be a student or he's not a student, he'll be done. Ken and I, as he mentioned earlier, had the privilege to work together on a book called Great Leaders Grow. I believe that your capacity to grow determines your capacity to lead. And so best decision any leader can make at any age is I will commit to lifelong learning.
Great. Mark, I have a request from Cindy that you could go back to the previous slide that shows the serve model. Would you mind to go back to that one? Thanks so much. Okay, so I'm trying to prioritize these questions. And here's one that comes in from Crystal. She's wondering what you should do if your leader, the CEO, isn't a great leader. And what she means is that the person has great ethics and integrity, but is very hands-off.
Well, my feeling is that what you need to do is get to know leaders and develop. Remember, your boss has position power, you got personal power, and what can you do to get to know them, per se, so at some point you can sit with them and say, you know, here's what I could use from you, a little more hands-on, or I could use this and all, but now you have a relationship, rather than coming off the wall and you don't even know them and saying, you know, you're too laissez-faire for me, I need this, and they're going to sort of say, have you got your resume ready? to go somewhere else. So develop relationships up the hierarchy, and then you can ask for what you need. I always say to people, would you take a bet that the worst you can do is break even? You're either going to win or you're break even. Wouldn't you take that to Vegas? Sure. So if you ask for what you need and you get it, you've won. If you don't, you've broken even because you didn't have it in the first place.
Yeah, the only thing I would add to that, I actually wrote a post. I had a question from a leader that said, my boss is not growing, what do I do? And I think that's the reality for a lot of people. And I'm reminded every time I get on an airplane, my answer is, in the event the loss of cabin pressure, put your own oxygen mask on first. Is you will never be able to serve your leader well unless you put your own mask on first. So it's unfortunate if they're not growing or leading well, but we cannot allow that to become an impediment for us, because we're no good to anybody if we don't put our own mask on first.
That's very helpful. Thanks to you both for that. I did have a question that came in earlier related to how to serve effectively in a virtual environment or remote environment, and then another question on the same topic of, you know, how can you perceive performance when you're remote from your team?
Well, let me say this. I'm going to say very little here because we're trying to figure that out as an organization. But based on limited exposure and research that we're now doing, I think you've got to be real clear on performance objectives. Because when you say you can't observe performance, most of the people I know who are having success with remote workers, there are very clear outcomes predetermined and defined in advance. But that's a journey we're on as an organization, so that's about all I've got on that. Ken, you got anything else?
Just to back that up, if you can't measure something, you can't manage it. And so it's even more important, I think, as Mark is implying, with remote people, that it be very clear performance standards so both you and they can be observing the performance. And then, you know, whether it's online or periodically on the telephone or what have you, you can review those and see what kind of help they need, either to improve the performance or praise them for their progress or whatever.
And I guess the only thing I'll add, Becky, is I think the serve model still applies. I just think it's much more tricky. The people still have to see the future. They still got to understand the vision. They've still got to feel engaged. There still has to be appropriate reinvention in place and so forth and so on. So I don't think it changes what has to happen. I think what changes potentially are the methods for accomplishing that. And as an organization, we're on that journey trying to figure that out.
Got it. Thanks so much. I have a question here from Andrea, and she's wondering what the one behavior is that you've seen that's derailed more leaders' careers.
I think that may actually transition to a question that Ken challenged our readers with 10 years ago. Are you a serving leader or a self-serving leader? I actually believe that leadership is fundamentally a choice. And I think what derails most leaders is they choose poorly. They choose to be self-serving. And I think game over. I think you have chosen in that decision to limit your influence, to limit your impact. I think that is the fundamental question that all of us have to ask often.
And I would agree with Mark like that, because the behavior of self-serving leaders that gets them in trouble is that they become seagull managers. You know, they're not around until somebody makes a mistake, and then they fly in, make a lot of noise, dump on everybody, and then fly out. Well, where a servant leader, if they see there's a problem, they move in, and their first question is, "How can I help?" Not "How can I, you know, punish or attack you or that kind of thing." They're there to help, not to swoop in.
Well, I think that's a really powerful idea to close with, that question of, "Are you a serving leader or a self-serving leader?" Mark, if you can get to the last slide, I think there's some follow-up of ways that folks can get in touch with either you or Ken, including your websites where you post content regularly and your Twitter handles. Of course, the book, The Secret, is available on Amazon. Many of you who are on the call likely have already posted reviews of The Secret. I'm going to put in a quick plug that if you've read and enjoyed the book, we would appreciate your reviews on the new edition of The Secret. And Mark and Ken, do you have any closing thoughts as we end today's event?
Well,
go ahead, Mark.
Go ahead. I'll go back to where I was just a moment ago. I'm excited. The reason I travel around the world sharing this content is that I believe leadership is fundamentally a choice. If you go back and look at those practices, with the possible caveat around structure, we may not control that, although we can influence it. Everything else contained within the serve practices is a choice that every leader makes every day. And I love that. I don't want anybody else determining how good a leader I'm going to be. I want to set my own bar. And so that's why I'm so thankful that when we did this work initially, that Ken pushed us. These practices are timeless. They are universal, and they are fundamentally a choice, and that excites me.
Yes, and just to build on that is is that I think we all have two selves. We have an external task-oriented self, and we have a thoughtful, reflective self. And which one of those wakes up quicker in the morning? Your external, task-oriented self. The alarm goes off. And I have my friend John Ortberg always said, "Why are we called the alarm clock. Why don't we call it the opportunity clock, or it's going to be a great day clock. But the alarm goes off, and it kicks you into your task-oriented self, and you jump out of bed, and you're trying to eat while you're washing, you know, and you jump in your car, and you're racing this meeting, that meeting, here, there, and all. Get home at 8 or 9 o'clock at night, absolutely exhausted, don't have energy. Say goodnight to somebody who might be lying next to you, and boom, next day you're out again. And what happens is you get caught in a rat race, you know. And when you're a rat race, you're really into survival. And the Lily Talman, the great philosopher from Hollywood, said, the problem with a rat race is even if you win it, you're still a rat. But what you need to do is find a way to enter your day slowly. And the first question you want to ask yourself is the one that Mark ended with, is how can I serve today? Am I going to be here to serve or be served? And have some time for reflection to set a vision for your day. And then at the end of the day, sit there before you go to sleep and say, how did I do today? And it might set you up to do some apologies or what have you and all. But make it a proactive choice, as Mark is saying. It is a choice, but you have to have time to think through your choices and don't get caught and become a stimulus response machine.
Boy, that is really helpful. And unfortunately, we've reached the end of our time together. So I want to, again, thank you, Ken and Mark, for joining us today. We have shared some info about how you can get The Secret, and we will be sending follow-up as well as a recording in case you want to share this content with people in your organization. Thanks so much, and have a fantastic day.
Thanks, Becky. Thanks, Ken.
Good. Great to be with you, Mark and Becky.
Take care. Bye-bye.